and welcome to this evening's planning committee. My name is Councillor Denise Reilly and I'm the deputy chair of the committee. Chair is unfortunately unwell and she gives her apologies. My role this evening is to ensure that the committee runs smoothly with regard to procedure, behaviour and ethics. To explain, the rest of the people are on the table here tonight. To my immediate right is the council's solicitors who give advice to the committee on any procedural matters and that matters that may arise. To my left are the council planning officers, highways, engineers and environmental health officer who present the applications this evening and give technical advice to the committee which may be sought. The rest of the people who you see both down both sides are the councillors who will be making the decision this evening. Before each planning application is considered, there will be a short presentation by the planning officer, Matthew. In the event of this an application has been received, a qualified petition signed by 25 signatories or more, one representative of the petition will be invited to address the committee in support of the petition for up to 5 minutes. If a petitioner addresses the committee, then the applicant or their agent will be invited to make a representation to the committee in support of their application. Again, for up to 5 minutes. However, if a petitioner has not addressed the committee, then the applicant or their agent will not be invited to make any representations. Any ward councillor can address the committee in relation to any application. The ward councillor may speak for as long as they wish. However, once the ward councillor has returned to the public gallery, they may not take part in any debate. The application will then be open to debate for discussion by members of the planning committee who will then make a decision on the application. The order of tonight's agenda will be as it is in the agenda, sorry, subject to the numbers of people who are in relation to a specific agenda item, but it's not, it's going to be as it is anyway. If a site visit is requested and approved by the committee this evening, that matter will not be discussed any further tonight. The matter will be discussed at a subsequent meeting once the planning committee has visited the site. Anyone here this evening for that item are welcome to leave the meeting if you so wish. Okay. Right, minutes of the meeting, the last meeting.
So moved, Chair.
Yeah.
All agreed?
Yeah.
Agreed.
Declarations of interest.
Yes, thank you, Chair. I need to declare a declaration of interest on items 4, which is 3 Ramsford Lane, Newton, and item 9, which is Bay Tree Farm, Crankby Road. This is a personal interest by virtue of the fact that I do know the applicants on both these applications very well.
Thank you, David. Anybody else?
Yeah, Chair. With due regard to item 10, not be disposing, it's an SDA application which we are familiar with. I've now been made known to me that the applicant is Brian Kenny, who is a personal friend of mine and a fellow councillor. So I'll be declaring a personal interest, not taking part in the meeting. I consider Brian to be a very close personal friend.
Could you just have a clarification on that, Chair?
Yeah.
Likewise, you
know. Or is councillor? He's a member of the Labour group, so, and he's the applicant, and the agent is also a member of the Labour group, so this is why.
And if the fellow councillor of itself wouldn't be a prejudicial interest, provided that you are coming to the matter with an open mind, but if that goes beyond that, that the colleague and his personal friend, I don't know which interest.
So, clarity, ma'am, if in addition to being a fellow council, he's personally friend, then we should declare him as a member.
Yeah, if you sort of socialise, you know, it's up to you, it's a personal decision for you, but if you regard it as over and above what you would normally, the relationship you would normally have with a fellow councillor, then I think I need a personal friend, I think it's right.
In which case, I'll see you very much.
Okay.
Anybody else? visits.
Yes, and thank you, Chair. I'd like to request a site visit for agenda item 6 on pages 32 to 44, which is Oravale's 135 Colby Road, Colby. There is a perception that this development could have a significant impact on the conservation area, and I believe it would be worthwhile to know that this site is an
Okay, thank you. Any more site visits, anybody? So if anybody is here for item 6, which is Oravale's...
We have a vote on it,
So is that okay by everybody? Site visits?
Yeah?
Agreed. If anybody is here for item 6, 135 Colby Road, Colby, that item would not be there tonight.
Just make one other point. I don't think to mention the fact that item 16 had been withdrawn. That's how it's
Thank you for reminding me, David. Item 16 on the agenda tonight, which is the land north of number 1 Rock Park, Rock Lane East, and the Escalade in Rock Ferry. That will not be there tonight either. That's been withdrawn. Okay, so we'll go back to the agenda, which is item number 4, which is 3 Grand School Lane, Newton.
Thank you, through you, Chair. Planning Commission has sought the erection of 3 dwellings in the garden area of 3 Grammar School Lane. The plans have been amended since they were first submitted, resulting in the loss of 1 dwelling. The site is located within the primarily residential area, and the principle of new residential development is acceptable subject to policy HS4, which relates to new housing development. The proposed development will result in 3 detached dwellings sited along the Grammar School Lane frontage of the application site. The new dwellings would be 2.5 stories in height, split across different levels, making use of the land levels across the site. The second floor accommodation entirely contained in the roof space, therefore giving the appearance externally of 2-storey dwellings. The new dwellings have been sited to ensure comfortable spacing between the proposed and existing dwellings adjoining the site, and elevations and windows have been positioned to meet the council's separation distances and avoid any adverse impact on adjoining properties or within the site. Integral garages and driveways are proposed for each property in keeping with parking provision for 4 and 5 bedroom houses. A new footpath is proposed along the full width of the site, which would be an improvement as a footway does not currently exist. The footpath would be made from land within the application site and would not result in reducing the width of the Grammar School Lane at this point. Each property would have its own garden space and the host dwelling, 3 Grammar School Lane, would also retain its own private amenity space. The site is well landscaped and there are a number of trees across the site. The proposals will necessitate the removal of a number of trees, but an agricultural appraisal has been submitted with the application and has been carefully considered by the council's tree officer. The removal of some trees will allow for the continuation and better management of the healthy tree population, and replacement planting is also proposed. A number of conditions proposed will secure protection measures together with soft and hard landscaping details. All permitted development rights are proposed to be removed, giving the council full control to properly consider the impacts of any future extensions, alterations or other additions. The construction management plan is also proposed, taking into account of such details as routes for construction traffic, hours of operation, and wheel cleaning facilities. The proposals are considered to be of a scale which relates well to surrounding property and the layout of other blocks within the vicinity. The design and siting of each new property is also considered to be acceptable. The proposals are recommended for approval. There is no petition of objection on this application.
Matthew. Is there any more councillors? No? Let's open to the committee then. Okay. Anybody?
Looking, sorry, Chair, looking at
consultation for the footpath. Could we put a condition that the footpath is built before they start the building of the houses?
Through you, Chair, that's covered in the construction management plan.
Anybody else? Questions? Committee? No? Well, the officer's recommendation is for approval. Do we have a proposer? Matthew? Seconder? Eddie? All those in favour?
This application seeks hazardous substance consent to increase the storage of gasoline from 17,000 tonnes to 24,064 tonnes. The principle of a chemical storage facility at these premises is long established, and there is a history of previous consents for the storage of hazardous substances on this site. The site is located within an area of mixed land uses which are predominantly industrial in nature. There are, however, some residential properties located just north of the site, along Bankfields Drive. When dealing with the applications for hazardous substance consent, the planning authority is required to have regard to a number of considerations, and those are set out on page 29 of your agenda and in policy context. Regardless, we have to the degree of off-site risks being within acceptable limits. In relation to this application, no additional storage vessels are proposed and no additional building works are proposed. The application seeks to increase the storage of gasoline by 6,064 tonnes within the same building area as currently used at the site. The wider site as a whole has a hazardous substance consent for storage of significant quantities of substances totaling nearly a million tonnes of storage. In this context, therefore, a small increase of just over 6,000 tonnes of additional gasoline storage is not considered to create any impact on the wider area. The Health and Safety Executive have concluded that risks to the surrounding population arising from this consent are so small that there are no grounds to refuse the application. The increase now sought is also less than has previously been consented in the 1990s. The application is recommended for approval. There is no particular objection on this application.
Thank you, Matthew. Shall we go to Ward Councillor?
Both. Thank you. There's just a few questions, basically. I understand the reason and argument behind what's being put forward. I understand the legislation and why it would be very hard for this authority to object to what's being proposed. Coma site is virtually doubling in size because of the extended storage of hazardous goods. Is there any notification to the nearest properties, not the houses that you can see in Bankfields, which are right next to the site, but the one that's used on a regular basis with their campers? Given the topography of the land there, the tents are at the top of the hill, the go-kart track, which is now an international one, much to my displeasure, because of the noise to the residents. it is camped on a regular basis. I don't know what the effect if the common stand being covered in science would have on that particular.
Thank you, through you, Chair. Anybody who shares an immediate boundary with the silence consulted on the application? I know we're on the site notices posted as well, giving opposite to the application. Impacts for anybody immediately adjacent to the site or even in the wider area were considered both by the council, colleagues in environmental health, and by the health and safety executive. And as I said in my presentation, because of the small amount of additional storage that's proposed by this application, the risks to surrounding land use is considered to be so small that there isn't really any justification to refuse the application.
If I may, just to follow the comment that's highlighted in the report itself, is the influx of objections by local residents after the alarm system that went off in the early hours of the morning. This is an alarm for 2 hours. It's got a major impact and major effect on local residents that are covered by the fallout regime that follows on with the alarm set in this place. People are notified of what's happening to have hazardous substance in the local community. I think the volume of objections related to another application which should have gone to this local authority, but the developers have decided to take it to national government instead, which will actually cover the site. As you can see, it's just been in this particular slide, the opposite side of the heavy mountains. So it's something that's an accumulation of stuff that's going to happen in the future. Hopefully we'll be able to give a good reason argument to try and stop it. But as an authority, I'm just explaining the reason why there was an influx of...
I think, David, if you wanted us to have a site visit or taking it in there, then you should ask for a site visit when I ask for site visits.
I didn't say it was a site visit.
So...
I'm just pointing out the particular issues that were raised.
It's got nothing to do with this.
I was explaining to the committee the reason why there was an influx of objections to this particular site. You understand what's written in the report?
Just to be clear, that application is not determined, and members need to be careful not to predetermine something that might come before the committee in the future. But again, it's not relevant to this application.
You can't come to this committee because the company decided to take it to national
committee. Excuse me, Dave.
Sorry, just explaining to the officer.
Yeah, we just need to keep the item on the agenda, please. I'm not steer away. Did you want to speak, Steve?
Some clarification. Was David, were you speaking as a ward councillor or as a member of the committee? Or
I was speaking as both.
Okay, yeah. Right. I'm clearly interest in this site is heightened. Any application on this site, from my knowledge over many, many years, does raise issues because it is what it is. It is a large storage of hazardous materials. But that is the established use for this site, has been for many years. It's what makes living on an estuary exciting because we receive goods from all over the world, chemicals, products from all over the world. And as long as this bank committee is sure that it meets all the criteria necessary, the storing of hazardous materials, and there are other bodies outside this room that will ensure that as well as the planning application, there's no valid reason for objection. And I know many people who live in that area wish it hadn't been built there, was never there, or never would be there. But my view is that there isn't a valid reason for objection. So to help progress, I'll remove the recommendations.
Can I just say, I haven't even actually opened it up to committee.
Well, that's why I was confused. He said he was speaking as a member of the committee. So
oh, that was the bottom. My response was
wrong. I'll open it up to committee. Has anybody else got any questions? No, so we'll go. The recommendation is for approval. Can I have a mover?
Move it. Just have.
Objector. Seconder. Seconder. Bruce. All those in favour? Against? That's carried. Item number 6 is a site visit. So item number 7 is 38 Poplar Road in Oxford.
Planning permission is sought for the erection of a single-storey extension to the rear of number 38 Poplar Road. The extension fills in gaps at the rear of the existing property, square below the property at ground floor level. So just to explain for members, the existing house at the moment, my screen isn't very good, so we'll have a look at that one. Runs like this, then it comes in, then it goes down, then it comes in, and in again. And all of this element is two-storey. So the proposal is to infill this area with the extension. So along the south-facing boundary, that's this bit here. The extension would project some 2.3 metres beyond the existing elevation. And then along the north-facing elevation, that's the one adjacent to number 46, Poplar Road, that's this boundary here. That would extend some 10 metres. So the extent of that element of the extension is 10 metres along the party boundary. However, the property at number 36 has also been extended at the back. That has an extension that comes out just short of 5 metres. So in terms of the extension in relation to number 36, it will actually project an additional 5 metres beyond the extension that's already been built at number 36. The other thing to take into consideration, just make it out here, this dotted line that runs along here, down here and along there is a 2.6 metre high boundary wall that runs right along the boundary of the site. So for the most part, the extension at 38 would be covered by a 2.6 metre high boundary wall. And then finally, the other thing to mention is that the land would be excavated, so the extension at number 38 would sit lower in land level than number 36. So, in essence, what you would see from number 36 at ground floor level anyway is just this top bit of the roof here, and as the wall steps down, this element here. So that's what you can see from the adjacent property at number 36. Originally, this part of the extension of the roof, which slopes at its highest level here, down the site to its lowest level at the back end of the site, all of this was originally proposed to be glazed, so it was a fully glazed roof. However, there were some significant building regulation issues with the extent of glazing that was proposed. So the application was amended so that this is now a slate roof with some additional roof lights, conservation roof lights. And we feel that that's a better solution actually, because you now don't get any overlooking from the adjacent properties through the glass roof into the new accommodation that's proposed at the bottom. And likewise, you wouldn't be able to look from the new accommodation upwards into the back elevation of any of those properties. So as I say, the plans have been amended to give a more traditional The application is considered to be appropriate in terms of its scale and appearance, having regard to those mitigating factors that I've set out for you. And while it wouldn't be visible from the street scene, the application is recommended for approval. There is no petition of objection on these proposals. We have, however, received a late objection from the residents at 36 Poplar Road, so these are the people here. And the objections that they've raised in their letter, I've spoken through why we feel those objections can't be sustained. So, as I say, the application is recommended for approval.
Thank you, Matthew. Is there any
ward
councillors? It's open to the committee then. Any questions, anybody? This is recommended for approval. Do we have a mover?
Yeah, I'll move approval.
Seconder? Eddie? Okay. All those in favour? Unanimous? Item 8, over to you, Matthew.
Thank you, Chair. My information is this was an application of the subject to the committee site visit on Monday. My information is sought for the erection of a two-storey building that will comprise of two retail units at ground floor and two self-contained flats above the first floor. The application is in outline and seeks to establish the principles of this development. The site is located within a traditional service centre which directs this sort of development to this location. Policy 8 SH2 allows for new retail units, whilst Policy SH7 allows for the use of the first floor for residential use. The site is currently vacant with existing access and drop curbs from Lisa Road. All residential windows at first floor face onto Lisa Road, and the properties along Lysett Road, which back onto the application site, are located 14 metres away from the nearest part of the proposal. Council guidance on habitable room windows facing the blank elevation, as is the case here, should be a minimum of 14 metres away. Therefore, the separation distances are achieved in this instance. The original proposals have been amended in order to soften the impact of the building, as it was felt that a new building in this prominent position required a scheme that contributed positively to the area's character. Lisa Road is suitably protected in terms of traffic control and the prevention of on-street parking due to double yellow lines within the vicinity of the site, which will prevent unsafe parking. The nature of traditional suburban centres is a small collection of retail uses aimed at serving the immediate local community, rather than encouraging travel from further afield. The site is also well served with public transport, bus routes along Lisa Road and Wallasey Village, and Wallasey Grove Road Station within northern distance. The proposed development would result in the redevelopment of a vacant site, which is felt with positive contribution to the street scene and the character of the wide area. The proposals are recommended for approval, and there is a qualified petition for objection.
Would the petitioner like to speak?
Yeah, that's me, no.
Okay. All councillors? No? Okay, so it's open to committee then.
Thanks, Chair, and thanks for all the members who were able to make the site visit on Monday, I think it was. I think this location really, it has been an eyesore for quite a while, and I'm sure out there there's a school of thought that any development on this particular location will be positive. But I just ask members to reflect upon what that would mean. It would mean that, in effect, we will allow developers to let their sites go into this type of condition, and then effectively will approve what type of proposed layout for. before us. Now, I'm not saying that those people in this committee who will vote in favour of the proposal tonight are thinking along those lines, but I'm just making the committee aware that there's certainly that school of thought out there. And I do think that developers such as this, and these are developers and landowners who we as a community have approached on numerous occasions to try and get this tied up, this site, and it's only happened once, do make play on that school of thought. So I'm just asking the committee to consider that this evening. I mean, obviously it's very subjective in terms of the impact it will have on the character of the area, and also in terms of overdevelopment and whether it be overbearing for the residents of Lycett Road. I just refer members to the planning history really of this site. It certainly in my living memory, what has been there before has only ever been a single story public toilet block. I think it shows here in the planning history there was also a police substation, but that was very much only single story, and was I assume the size of the toilet block as well. So there's never been anything of such size on this particular site previously. I do think it would be overbearing and will have a harmful impact on the character of the area, and have some ways to move refusal, Chair, if it comes to that.
Anybody else like to speak?
Well,
for
the benefit of those members who didn't make this the site visit, just some observations. I agree with Paul, we shouldn't consider whether the site's tidy, pretty or not, and I just think of it purely in plan applications. But there was certainly some evidence at the rear of the site of nuisance dumping and issues going on in and around the site. I may have had more sympathy with objections to the site had it not sort of been the extension of that block. So if you look at the blocks that come around the corner, there are developments with a floor above. Had then residential area started, I may have had some sympathy that was the end of the sort of shopping area and the beginning of the residential area. But as you can see, right along the site is a 24-hour garage. So it is actually still part of what I would consider the sort of, to be the shopping centre, town centre shopping development. So it is quite appropriate for further shopping or development with residential above to be part of the extension of that corner, so I couldn't really find any objection there. I do have a little bit of sympathy for the residents, and particularly one resident who turned up about, perhaps it would take light or overbearing view, but we know, planning committee, we've had some reassurance about distances in that. So if I could take any positive, take some positives away from it, and some, some difficulty in understanding why. But I know Horsley Village does come together quite often to promote itself as a shopping entity in its entirety, from one end of Horsley Village to the other. This is a sign of, if you like, confidence, encouragement, that someone's prepared to try to invest and extend the development. It was also quite worrying that the two units, particularly adjacent to that, were empty and not filled. So in terms of planning, your planning application, I can see little or no reason for objection, and there will be some benefits from the tidying up of that site, I accept. But that's not the overriding fact is that it is a quite unexpected development in a shopping area, and we'll find very difficult to spot that.
Thank you, Chair. I just want to say that whilst I agree with Steve, I've got the same thing before. I've noticed loads of areas within the borough of Jericho House which have been allowed to go to some extent back in the room. And I've then seen these areas with proposals for some kind, sometimes inappropriate group development. Yet, it's been the case, everyone's back, everyone's mind, it's difficult not to have that back in mind. But it'd be good to see a site come back into use. And it's difficult to not be suspicious that these places will soften. Or I just want to express some people what I can't say using the plan at all.
Eddie
first,
thank you, Jed. I was the one who went to the site visit, and I agree exactly with what Steve was saying, but the only problem I've got is the substation in the back. Now, I realised that we were there Monday and it was 3 hours parked with its health and safety access to the substation. If we propose and it's accepted that the building happens to be curious where whatever, I don't know. But basically, I agree with what Steve was saying.
I think that access road would still remain there anyway, where their cars were parked, so that's up to irresponsible car owners where they park their car. That's got nothing to do with this application.
Thank you, Chair. Just following on, I totally concur with what Steve said. I also went on the site visit. It seemed to me a beneficial use of a piece of derelict land. I do share any concerns about the site boundary as shown on the screen there. Looks as though the site is contains the substation itself, which of course it doesn't. There are some issues there that were confusion of how it would create problems of obstruction getting to the substation in the event of a problem. The other thing, of course, is this is an outline application. All we're doing is agreeing in principle. We haven't seen the detail. If we didn't like the detail, I would like officers' confirmation that it would come before us again and we'd be able to comment on it if it turned out to be something that was peculiarly obnoxious. Could you confirm that would be the case?
If I keep through the chat, it wouldn't automatically come to committee unless it was taken out of delegation. But yes, a reserve matters application would need to be submitted, which would cover the details of the application if our planning permission is granted tonight.
Thank you.
Any more?
Sorry, mine's just, I think like everyone else, know the site quite well, and I think you know, redevelopment of it would be a benefit to the local community. But there's one question I've just got under condition 8. Which was obviously the bus stop that's in front of the site. Now, it says there that the relocation of the existing bus stop or shelter into Markham Bay will be done, and that will be the mayor's trouble to decide. Is there any way we can get assurance that that bus stop within a certain distance won't be lost, only because it is a very well used one and quite busy?
We won't lose the bus shelter, it'll just be relocated and we'll confer the town manager.
Can I speak?
I just want to remove refusal as an indicator, Chair, that's okay.
Okay, my refusal on grounds that the proposed development by virtue of its scale, bulk and massing would represent an overdevelopment of the site that would have an adverse impact on both the street scene and the wider character of the area, due to its design, form and relationship with neighbouring properties. The proposed development would represent an unneighbourly form of development which would appear overbearing and oppressive when viewed from neighbouring properties, particularly when viewed from the rear elevations and garden areas of residential properties located along the Leicester Road, resulting in a harmful impact on residential amenity. The proposal is therefore contrary to policies HS2 HS7 of the Liberal UDP.
Thank you. Do we have a seconder? All those in favour of Paul's refusal, please show your hands. Against? So we'll go back to the original, which is officer's recommendation is for approval. Do we have a mover? And a seconder? Thank you. All those in favour? Against? That's approved. Thank you. Right, item number 9, which is Baytree Farm Factory, chaired by David again. Cardboard and the creation of a residential curtilage. The
The site is located within the Greenbelt and Frankenby Conservation Area. It was first given planning permission for the erection of an agricultural barn in 2006. Local and national planning policies allow for the reuse of existing buildings, and as such, these proposals are not considered inappropriate development, as both the UDP and the National Planning Policy Framework allow for such development to be permitted. The barn has been in situ for some period of time, approximately 9 years. Whilst it is not a traditional stone barn, it is nevertheless a substantial structure that is capable of conversion, as demonstrated by a submitted structural report. The barn has an external appearance of vertical timber boards. This appearance would be substantially retained, giving the appearance of this building when viewed from the main road as an agricultural building. The main changes are to the northwest facing elevation, which looks over the adjacent open land. These alterations have been kept relatively simple, and as such, it's not considered that the proposals will detrimentally impact on the character of the building. Subject to the removal of an additional structure on site, which is larger than the proposed carport, it is not felt that the proposals would result in any greater impact on the openness of the Greenbelt. Unfortunately, I wasn't able to attend the site visit on Monday, but one of my colleagues was there, and I understand that they talked through a plan with you, and that there was some confusion about that plan and the position of the carport. Just so that, that positioning is clear, the carport would be located roughly in this location here and would be set 2 metres off the boundary, so it wouldn't be hard against the hedgerow that those who were present on site saw. So just to be clear that it isn't hard against the boundary as members. the proposed creation of residential cursorage within the boundary formed by the side of the barn at the edge of the field to the north of the barn, making use of existing natural boundaries, which it is felt creates a logical area to use around the barn. The impact on the greenbelt can be minimised by strengthening the existing planting, and the removal of permitted development rights in relation to additional ancillary buildings and structures in the area, such as garden sheds and children's play equipment. The impact on the conservation area is considered to be neutral, as the building exists and the conversion retains the appearance of the building when seen from outside the site. The application is recommended for approval. There's no petition or objection in relation to this.
Frankenby is one of those very special villages in the world which retains